Okay, great.
Hiya. So how do you want to proceed? We've got three helpers here in the room.
Okay, fantastic. Hey, everyone in person, that's awesome.
Yep, so we can help you out with the timing for people that are here. Virtual, you can do the timing if you like.
Okay, yeah, we'll go ahead and get started so that we stay on time. And greetings, my name is Nate Upham. Becca, you wanna say hi?
Hi, everyone, Beckett Sterner at Arizona State.
Yeah, also at Arizona State. And I'm also giving the first talk, so I can kind of share my slides and get moving in that direction. Okay, awesome. So today our seven talks in this symposium are going to be sort of thematically united around this idea of extended taxonomic curation. And in particular, thinking about moving beyond just this traditional idea of a taxonomic authority that curates a list of accepted and perhaps synonymous species, towards how that those taxonomic entities are ultimately linked to observations and species data. So some really cute mammals here to kind of remind everyone of the grounding of this type of work. It can get very abstract, so we want to ground it in real world examples. But sort of this idea of taxonomic intelligence is one of the things we want to put forward. And that's this idea of keeping track of the meaning of what a given taxonomic name has through time, and that the identical name can shift quite a bit, as many of you are well aware. So thinking about Paramiscus as a genus has increased by 25 species. And then Microcebus mouse lemurs as another example of a lot of splitting and taxonomic change in meaning. So another kind of key idea that I want to put forward in this talk is this idea of species meaning artifacts, that we can kind of grab the essence of a species name meaning through something that we're calling smarts. So I'll be talking more about that. So an example of a smart could be a range map. Right, and that's sort of something that we intuitively have in our heads. We're like, oh, okay, like, which definition of that species do you mean? Well, let me draw it on a map. So if you look at these Microcebus mouse lemurs in Madagascar in 2008, kind of a very different set of species that you get in 2014, and then another different set of species in 2020. And these differences are largely represented in the range maps. For example, this Microcebus rufus shows a different, like quite a different delineation, from the entire eastern Madagascar to this range-restricted position. And so a lot of that is because of the taxonomic splitting, not necessarily, but some of it is also due to habitat loss. But these are things that we also want to keep track of. This idea that species meanings are changing through time according to different versions of the IUCN Red List, or according to some other authority. So why does this matter, right? Like the kind of zoom out and say, okay, what are we really talking about here? Species are the tips of trees and phylogenies, and that's to reconstruct evolutionary history, look at common ancestry, and they're also the kind of important observational point in the present day, trying to understand ecological interactions between species here in the Sonoran Desert, for example, or elsewhere. And that's sort of the key to knowing other things, right? If we want to be investigating evolutionary questions or ecological questions, we need to have a taxonomy with which to communicate information. So that kind of leads to this first question of, how do we best link taxonomic updates that are happening all the time? As we know, things are always sort of changing. At least we want to keep track of how they change, and in particular with respect to biodiversity observations. And then it's sort of, okay, well, there's this taxonomy and there's that other taxonomy, and how does that, what am I supposed to do? People often get frustrated at this point. But it is theoretically possible and practically feasible, as we'll talk about, to actually have multiple taxonomies that are fit for a given use. And you could potentially interconvert your biodiversity observations between one and two taxonomies here, and then treat this like an evolutionary question, or just a scientific question, right? To test their impact on your results. Does it matter if you use one taxonomy or the other? If it's robust to both, that's even better. And so one of the ways, societal ways where this becomes really important is, now we're thinking about pathogen spillover, viruses in this case, and we want to know something like which species of mammals have the highest risk of giving a virus to humans, or which regions, kind of similar question. This has largely been studied sort of without the host species in the center, right? It's been largely just what are the viruses, where are the humans? So the ecology and the taxonomy of the host species is really important here, but it's the same idea of like, we need to be able to interconvert taxonomies of observational data. And so when we kind of, zoom into the fundamentals here, we have this, given occurrence records, kind of this evidence of organisms can be, an iNaturalist sighting, museum specimen, or it could be like, catch and release tissue that has DNA sequences, has some sort of locality. That kind of zooms in or, gets scaled up to taxa, where, you have a taxonomic treatment that reference certain data, from certain specimens, perhaps, or other occurrences. And then, you get that described into a type specimen, species name. This whole idea of nomenclature and labeling data by names is really rooted in what we do here. The other side of this, though, is that the meaning of those names is changing all the time, right? There's multiple name usages, and then they maybe each have associated data that give meaning to those usages. So that's sort of what I was talking about at the beginning, this idea of species meaning artifacts, and that we can actually label data according to the meaning, to a given meaning. It doesn't have to be the original meaning, but it can be a subsequent meaning. And that really helps us be more intelligent about the way we deal with that data. So currently there's really no feedback loop here between those observations and the species name usages. It's happened irregularly, if ever, and generally manually. So this idea of extended taxonomic curation really focuses on how do we, use that smart data, and really start curating that relative to changes in taxonomy and use that to update taxonomic labels on biodiversity data. So sort of the current situation, what we're doing here, there's been some really awesome efforts in curating taxonomic treatments, digitizing them, extracting them from PLOTSI, led by Donat Agusti, and including these sort of specimens that are in the taxonomic treatment, so referred or type, and those are now like getting fed directly into GFIP. This is awesome. Similarly, the species names are being kept track of by Zobank, but not necessarily in a connected way to the treatment. On the other side of it, via the species name usages, a lot of different entities are involved in creating aspects of this, but sort of in a disconnected way with their own taxonomic backbones that are not necessarily harmonized to the current literature necessarily, right? Like things can be falling behind. NCBI sort of does its own thing. Open Tree of Life is amalgamating from other taxonomies. IUCN is sort of doing its on its own pace. So there's really this question of, who does this curation? Maybe many different entities do this curation, or perhaps no one. And I think this is sort of the problem that we're focusing on here. We've been focusing on some pilot work in global mammals to kind of try and root this in practical examples and build an intuition. And so the Mammal Diversity Database is an effort through the American Society of Mammalogists that I've been organizing, but we're now uniting with Mammal Species of the World, Bats of the World, and Arctos to create this thing called Mammal Species of the World Next. There's a lot of people involved here, collaborators on this talk and outside of it. Just want to acknowledge their efforts. And so the sort of framework of what we're thinking about here is really trying to build community curation of taxonomic meaning. I mean, there's a reason why it hasn't been, it's not commonly done. It's a lot of work. But if you can organize a system to have a kind of a like a distributed system and make use of many people's efforts, and then translate that across from biodiversity data through those names, it could be really interesting. So aligning historical taxonomic checklists can be a big part of this, kind of getting towards name usages, but then really curating that smart data that I was talking about relative to given name usages is a key piece of this. And so not just maps, also DNA sequences and those treatments. And then think about how to use those species meaning artifacts to disambiguate biodiversity data, right? So kind of like doing intersections, and I'll talk a little bit about this more, but you know, from a given species name usage to the observations, and then we can use machine learning actually to help us disambiguate this further. So the really prime example of this is with geospatial disambiguation. Here's an example in the North American deer mouse, one of the most common small mammals on GBIF, or mammals at all. And there's a proposed taxonomic split from 1 to 5 species here. And so kind of that name, Paramyscus maniculatus, will only be retained east of the Mississippi River if this is held. And so the approach that we took here was to use those new range maps that have been drawn, these new species meaning artifacts, and then intersect with the GBIF occurrence points relative to their spatial uncertainty. So there's kind of buffers around each of the occurrence points. And it's actually quite striking that 99%, we're able to get to 99% kind of relabeling here with this combination of initial intersections, and then kind of machine learning disambiguation kind of initially trained on the unambiguous data. So this ends up being quite promising, and we're excited about moving forward with this. So kind of to get back to, you know, the original questions that were raised here. So the idea of, you know, how do you link the taxonomic updates with observational data? One of the things we're proposing is this idea of, you know, really curating those species meaning artifacts, updating range maps when there's a taxonomic split, keeping track of which gene sequences go with which name usages, and then ultimately just intersecting that meaning with observational data. And that sort of goes, you know, to the next one. These are not separate questions, ultimately. That kind of enables this idea of fit for use taxonomy. To, you know, once you have this disambiguated biodiversity data, you can distribute it according to alternate taxonomic perspectives, and then allow people to, you know, test their hypotheses in this context. So with that, just thank my collaborators and other folks that have been involved in this project, including at the CTAP DISCO task force. And I'll take any questions. Thank you.
And I think we have one question in the chat that I can see on Zoom from Carlos, who says, geography is not part of the meaning, e.g. taxon diagnoses. That is a common misconception even among taxonomists. Geography, areas of distribution, et cetera, are not characters or character states in the taxonomic sense, but rather attributes for broader classification of characters, attributes, and I'm not sure what that is. He points us to Dubois 2017. So geography could be used to support the assessment of meaning, but please do not refer to it as a meaning bearer in the taxonomic sense. I wanted to see if you had a response there, Nate.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, I mean, like in a taxonomic sense, it would be the characters, so morphologic or genetic, behavioral. And so there's that potential too. The problem in that context is you start dealing with homology issues. It's like, okay, you just get all the matrices out of a given paper or set of papers and keep track of those. That can be good, but it doesn't necessarily scale beyond like a given taxonomic scope. And so, yeah, like I think we have to just think about practically how we were dealing with this here, and try and balance, you know, this sort of strict taxonomic sense to the way people actually use the data. And I will say that like the type of example that we showed with Paramiscus, you know, works best when everything's reciprocally allopatric. That's pretty obvious, right? And then there's some more complex examples when things are sympatric. They can nevertheless be, as long as they're partially not sympatric and you can train the machine learning algorithm on traits that are unambiguous. And then that is one way that the morphological data can actually come in, is trying to do that machine learning step of the disambiguation. Okay, let's go to the next talk. And
that's Samantha Oriana.
Awesome. Yes, hello everyone. I was going to present live, but I have some problems with my slides, so they are going to share the recording.
Samantha, are you guys getting the audio?
Allowing instant data publication can work as aggregators if we import data already available in other SimBiota portals or other platforms, and can also work as SimBiota installations for GBIF and IDigBio, allowing collections to publish their data directly into these regional and global platforms. SimBiota portals can have a taxonomic original scope depending on the community behind them. For example, this is the SciNet portal, focused mainly on the flora of North America. There are more than 45 SimBiota portals worldwide. Today, we will focus on the Guatemala Biodiversity portal, which was created on September of 2020. By the team at Arizona State University in collaboration with Guatemalan institutions. So far, 30 collections and 6 observation projects are being directly managed in this portal, including plant, animal, fungi, and fossil collections from this country. The portal is available in English and Spanish, and you can find the link easily on Twitter if you follow at Guatemala Portal. This portal, like all SimBiota portals, have a taxonomic thesaurus with previously integrated names from different sources. The standardization of scientific names in SimBiota portals aim to facilitate the work of collection managers by helping them to avoid typing errors during data entry. A drop-down menu will be available with the names included in the thesaurus in the data entry form. Another important goal of maintaining a taxonomic thesaurus in a SynBio portal is to link specimens with the different resources available and to make them searchable within the portal. The names not included in the thesaurus will not be linked to any resource. The names available in the thesaurus will link specimens to the search forms and to the species pages, at the same time connected with pages for higher groups, checklists, and other resources available within and outside the portal. In general, a taxonomic thesaurus is built within each SynBio portal using available taxonomic catalogs. For example, Catalog of Life and the World Register of Marine Species. Each portal has the option of batch loading taxonomic names via API. However, the names don't always include authorities and are usually only linked to superior groups like families and orders, depending on the taxon. So this means we often have to check each group to curate the classification according to specialized publications. And for a portal dedicated to all taxonomic groups from a small area like the Guatemala portal, it is not very practical just to download every name available in these catalogs. So in this case, we decided to start with a very basic catalog or thesaurus. And one of the first steps to add taxonomic groups and scientific names was to aggregate digitized records from collections in other SynBio portals that have a taxonomic scope, for example, are maybe better curated. And after aggregating the collections, we use the taxonomic cleaning tool available in the portal to analyze the name with Catalog of Life and Worms, importing them directly into the taxonomic thesaurus. Just by doing this, we have accumulated 44 aggregated collections from other SynBio portals and different platforms with more than 300,000 records from Guatemala and more than 21,000 scientific names now available in the thesaurus. Another way to add names to the taxonomic thesaurus in the portal is typing the names directly into the data form during specimen digitization. Curators can just type the names in and then run the taxonomic cleaning tool to analyze the new names and add them to the taxonomic thesaurus. Near 2,000 names have been added this way from 36 live managed collections and observation projects. If the names are not available in any of the online catalogs after a taxonomic cleaning, we also have the option of using the taxonomic editor tool where we can manually add the scientific name, author, and source, always associating the name with a superior taxon to build the thesaurus. Once the taxonomic record is created, this tool can also help us to change taxonomic placements, for example, if the classification has changed. And we also can update the name status if it's now a synonym, for example. We also use this tool to curate the taxonomic thesaurus in the portal by adding taxonomic groups that are not generally available in the online catalogs, like subfamilies or tribes in the case of insects. To update the taxonomic thesaurus in a more organized way, we are also using the checklist editor tool, where researchers can create checklists for their groups of interest. With access to the editing tools, they can also add the missing names manually or update the taxonomic status of the species if needed. The ability to create these interactive checklists and to edit the taxonomic thesaurus and the species pages is helping researchers to be aware of relevant updates for local information, such as new records for introduced species and new synonyms for local checklists of endangered species. for example, this tarantula is still included with the previous name in the official Guatemalan red checklist of endangered species and is now included with the current name in the portal. Taxonomic curation in a SeaBiota portal with multiple groups can present several challenges, like the presence of homonyms, synonyms, or even disagreements with the classification. In the case of homonyms, we have found arthropod specimens linked to plant families, for example, but we can easily solve this by carefully adding the authors to the genera and species using the taxonomic editor and by corroborating the taxonomic placement of each group. When we find outdated names, we can add the current names in the thesaurus and then link the synonym to be able to search specimens regardless of the name they have. And for the disagreements about the classification, we can generate several thesauri depending on the needs of the community. The Guatemala portal also works as an installation for GBIF, and it is actively being used by Guatemalan collections to publish and update new specimen records into this global platform. So, maintaining a well-curated taxonomic thesaurus is very useful to make easier the interchange of data into this global platform and to avoid taxonomic errors. Finally, I want to point that the curation of a taxonomic thesaurus in this or any SeaBiota portal is always a work in progress, and it depends on the active participation of the portal managers and the community of taxonomists and researchers involved. I want to make a special recognition to all the curators and researchers in the Guatemalan collections involved with this portal, because none of this would have happened without them. You can follow the portal accounts on social media if you want to learn more about the work in Guatemala. And you can contact me and the rest of the SeaBiota team for more information about this or any SeaBiota portals in SeaBiota.org or help@SeaBiota.org. Thank you very much to the organizers for the invitation to this symposium, and thank you for your attention.
All right, and I think we have a couple of minutes for a question. I'm not sure how to field from the room. Please let me know.
Does anyone have a question in the room? Might go online if you've got one online.
Well, I have a question if no one else does. Samantha, I hadn't heard about having multiple thesauri for the same portal before. How exactly does that work in terms of the user being able to see the same records, but on according to the different thesauri? Do they have to re-annotate them, or how is that being handled?
Oh, thank you, Beckett. Yes, there is an option when you search for specimens to change to the different thesauri. So you can just choose, and the taxonomy will be displayed according to the thesaurus you choose.
There's a question from Carlos, it looks like.
Okay, sorry, I wasn't sure if that was new or continuing the discussion. So Carlos asks, how to use the proper zoological categories, valid or invalid, for zoological names instead of botanical ones, accepted, not accepted. Keeping it as it is does not help in understanding zoological nomenclature. And this is also a problem in worms.
Okay, thank you. Yes, in origin, SeaBiota was created for herbaria, for plant collections, so it often have different terminology based on plants. So yes, we are not thinking about those changes, but we can think about updating these terminologies. And you can also send a request or a suggestion in our GitHub discussion for updates about the portals.
All right, thank you, Samantha.
Thank you.
Shall we switch over to Emily Sandahl and Aurora Moreed next?
Yep, we're here. Good morning. Greetings from Washington, DC. I'm just gonna go ahead and share my screen real quick. All right, is everyone able to see my screen? Cool. All right, so this morning we're going to be talking about our GIST project. So today I'll be presenting on getting the GIST, testing an integrative data structure for linking taxonomy, biodiversity, and conservation data. This is a project that's been going on for a couple years and led by me and my colleague, Aurora. We were at the Center for Biodiversity and Global Change at Yale, and I'll be talking about the work we did there. So I don't think that I have to tell this group of attendees that organizing life on Earth with names is complicated. And there are many more names than there are taxa that we know of and are described so far. And it is a lot of effort, either on the specific taxonomic group level to curate this data and to aggregate this data for broader analysis. And what we really wanted to focus on in our presentation is just in this project, how we were bringing together three really important communities that are interacting with this taxonomic data, in particular the taxonomy, ecology, and conservation communities, who have sort of a push-pull reaction to the data itself, where there's often a producer of the taxonomic data, but then there are also users who may not entirely understand that data and then are using it for broader analysis, but also for a whole bunch of different conservation actions or management planning related to the data itself. And we're living at a time when there's more data than ever. So this is obviously a really important community to bring together from these three different disciplines. And in the process of bringing together these different communities, we wanted to highlight that there are some really different perspectives that have to be integrated in order to really speak the same language and understand what we're all talking about here. And we wanted to kind of touch on how those different perspectives and values have to come together in order for us to really move forward and think broadly about how we're both generating and using taxonomic data in order to assess a whole bunch of different, mostly biodiversity questions. But all of these different users have different specialties and different priorities in how they're using the data, from integrating it to applying it and synthesizing it. So it's really complicated to kind of separate ourselves from these values that we hold. So that brings us to the structure itself. So what is the GIST? This is the acronym for the Globally Integrated Structure of Taxonomy, which is sort of the bare minimum elements and terminology that are needed in order to really be able to integrate data from a lot of different sources. And I'm just gonna go through this very brief example of bison. So for example, for bison, you can find it in a globally integrated list, which is the source of all accepted names for the taxon. The authorship information, so the author and publication years of a name to link the name history, and then the name sources and timestamp of a particular version of a master list so that you can easily tell where a particular choice of name is coming from, the occurrence or instance of a name being used itself with a timestamp on it, the spatiotemporal relationships, which connects back to what Nate was presenting on earlier, how complicated this can be to sort of identify the history of the species concept overall. And then the synonyms list, which is the source of names that can be matched to that global list. So all of these components, I think everyone can understand that they're really key and really important. But between the communities that I was talking about earlier, it might not necessarily have been the case that we've all had the same vocabulary understanding of what those different components are. And we're coming about this from the Map of Life and Center for Biodiversity and Global Change at Yale University, where what we've really been focusing on is how to harmonize large amounts of geospatial data. So that's really what we've been interested in at Map of Life, is putting species on the map and getting as many synonyms linked to a harmonized taxonomic backbone. So if you went to Map of Life, you'd be able to see this, the name that is accepted, and that would be visualizable on the portal itself, but this is also representing many different synonyms that are linked up through this harmonized backbone. So for the GIST itself, we had kind of the perfect case study to see how this would work in reality. So we wanted to test the Map of Life taxonomies, since we had many different experts who had particular taxonomic expertise and were putting together their own taxonomic backbones to maximize the geospatial data. We were able to look at multiple taxa and assess how well the GIST is actually working within those particular taxonomies when we were using a standardized approach in order to build them. So for each taxonomic group, we wanted to score the GIST components. So from having a single integrated known list that represented all taxa for a particular group, the quality of the synonyms list in terms of if it has all of the synonyms for one taxonomic group that can be found in one authority, or if it's coming from many, many authorities, the authorship information, how well is that associated with the individual names that are made up for that group, the name sources and timestamp for the source itself, and then how easy is it to track the spatiotemporal relationships, which you'll see is really challenging for almost all groups. There has been, obviously this is a really complicated thing to put together, and for many of the taxonomic groups that we were looking at, that has just not necessarily been an emphasis because it's so time consuming and complicated. So you can see that even though we had a standard approach for all of these different taxonomic groups represented within our center, we had really different GIST scores. So this just highlights how complicated this can be, especially in groups of very different sizes and that have their own taxonomic curating histories. Beyond just looking at the GIST components themselves, we wanted to see how well our taxonomies were able to be matched between other types of sources. And we wanted to select from across the different disciplines that we were trying to bring together. So from the taxonomy science, the biodiversity science, and conservation science. So examining how well our lists can match against regional checklists, the percentage of new accepted names in the last two decades representing the detail of taxonomic knowledge, the global species list. So seeing how, if we tested against catalog of life names, how many of those names had no match in ours. And then for biodiversity science, we looked at at name match in genetics, phylogenetics, and occurrence record databases to just see how well we're doing there. And then additionally, we wanted to bring in invasive species and IUCN red list names. So you'll see again that across the board, we have super different scores for the different taxonomic groups. So even with a standardized approach to how we're building these taxonomies, the amount of data that you can actually match against them is highly variable. But obviously the interoperability of taxonomies and the ability to link them together is really critical in a time where biodiversity is threatened almost universally. And there's a lot of work that needs to be done to understand the data coverage, species distribution modeling to understand where species are actually found, assessing things like richness and rarity to prioritize different areas. And then there are all kinds of macroecological synthesis questions that are enabled by this interoperability. So finding a way to really use the same language is critical in building these taxonomies, but also making them really useful and functional between different sources. So if we want to have truly integrated science, these are the absolute minimum components that we have highlighted need to be defined and useful in taxonomic data sources. But then there are also, as we were talking about earlier in our presentation, values and emphases that need to be placed within the communities in order to really enable this to work long-term. And those include harmonization, transparency, communication, highlighting our synergies, and increasing development and resources combined between the different communities to ensure that we're really maximizing what we can do with our taxonomies and not siloing ourselves and assuming that we have the right answer. I think that this is what we want the GIST to be is like a way of defining and providing metadata for people who might not otherwise be able to talk about this particular topic. But we would not say that this is the one end all be all. Like, obviously a lot of effort needs to continue to be placed in taxonomy. And even within our own group, if you look at our author list, we have a lot of different perspectives in there that we're trying to bring together and even get within ourselves on the same page of what we're talking about, which is really complicated. And all of these different subdisciplines that we come from have a history, and we're really trying to figure out the best way to unite that. And I just wanted to highlight that Aurore and I are no longer really at the Center for Biodiversity and Global Change at Yale. We have both since moved on, but this work is continuing. Aurore is moving on in a couple of weeks to a postdoc at Rutgers. And I have a science and technology policy fellowship through the AAAS, where I'm a biodiversity advisor for the USDA. So we're happy to continue this discussion and look forward to more about this work coming out soon. And with that, Aurore and I will take questions. These are our taxonomic groups that we curated taxonomies for, but happy to discuss further and take questions.
All right, and thanks, Emily. It's a great talk. Questions for Emily? We have a few minutes. For folks on Zoom, you can either raise your hand and I'll catch you at the top or post in chat and I'm happy to read. One in the room, thank you, Holly. Go for it.
Turn the mic on. This is James Macklin. Just wanted to say that this is really interesting. I mean, I think the data about the data is always relevant, but to me, what you've done is create a vivid illustration of the problem. The problem is there's not enough of us, right? Machines can't fix this. We have to have people on the ground who can be those authorities. Otherwise, we have gaps and we will not be able to solve that problem. So what we need to do is use that as the way, and you're now a policy person, to get to the policy people to say, hey, there's only one way to fix this. And that's to have more people on the ground. And that's training and education and, yeah, having jobs for those people when they get out of there. At least that's what it highlights to me.
Thank you for that. Yeah, I think that that is one way that we really frame this project is by having a bunch of people who are assembling these taxonomies. Like, we've really been able to identify the problem. It is really, really complicated to figure out how will you serve the community from start to finish in terms of like from producer to user. And I think that what you've highlighted is really important. Like, what does this mean in terms of training and jobs? And we didn't want this project to just be talking about like, well, obviously we need more taxonomists, because I think that everyone understands that. But what we really need is like a common language to highlight why this is so important and so critical to invest in.
All right, another quick question. Nate, go for it.
Yeah, maybe just to follow up, like this idea of a common language is for sure helpful. I guess just to play devil's advocate, you could also create like a translator, right? So that like everyone has different languages and then we can translate between them. I don't know, yeah, did you guys like see any sort of potential for that kind of thing?
That's a really great point. At this stage, that hasn't been an emphasis of what we're doing. But I think that there is a lot of opportunity there, especially as what we were really aiming to put together here is like the metadata and definitions. And I feel like that would be a really wonderful thing for us to be able to translate between languages in order to kind of unify the terms that we're using between languages. That's a super good point.
All right, and next up we have Rich Pyle talking about modeling taxon concepts.
Testing. Ah, good. Sorry for you online. I had to get mic'd up. So the challenge before me right now, 11 time zones out of phase for my sleeping, is to summarize decades of ideas and a couple of years of very intensive discussions into 12 minutes. I guarantee you, I will not cover everything that this presentation is meant to represent. My hope is that it'll be just provocative enough that it will prompt you to follow up with me and ask questions and have interesting philosophical discussions going forward. So, if you saw my presentation yesterday, you might remember this diagram, which I think is a very instructive representation of the problem we faced in biodiversity data. And it boils down to almost all biodiversity data are labeled with scientific names. However, most biodiversity data actually apply to taxonomic concepts, which we can think of as circumscriptions of organisms. And this diagram sort of shows that what's in the mind of a taxonomist may or may not translate well to the mind of the recipient of that information using only a text string scientific name. That's our fundamental problem. Now, if we could deduce these circumscriptions in a quantifiable way, we could do magical reasoning and processing using these RCC5 relationships that I talked about yesterday. But we have two primary challenges before we can get there. First of all, we need to assign identifiers to these circumscriptions, you know, themselves, but we can't do that until we define what these units actually are. And I'll get into why that's been a problem. But even if we could, even if we did have a consensus on how we're actually defining what a circumscription is and when it's the same or when it's different, even if we had that, how can we create these RCC relationships in a scalable and an objective manner? That is, in across millions of names without involving a whole lot of subjective interpretation by skilled taxonomists. So for the last 2 years, the three co-authors of this presentation, myself, Dave Remsen, and Nicolas Bailly, have been having weekly conversations over Zoom, and very, very, very interesting stuff. We only realize in hindsight we should have been recording them, but we're trying to capture all of that in a series of Google Docs, which will eventually see the light of the public world. But what I'm going to give you is sort of a summary of where we're at with this thinking. So how do we informatically distinguish taxon concepts or circumscriptions? And then the answer to that has never been easy, largely because there are three different components that always get conflated and always confuse the conversation. So one of those components is circumscription. That is the actual content of a taxon, all the organisms living, recently dead, and yet to be born, which collectively comprise someone's notion of a taxon. Then there's classification. That's a simple hierarchical arrangement of nested sets of circumscribed taxa, whether it's based on a phylogeny or just a simple Linnaean hierarchy. That's a second sort of notion that's embedded in taxonomy. And the third is nomenclature. That's where we code warriors get all excited about it and make sure you get the exact right text string label and it's spelled correctly and formatted correctly and given the right authorship. And that's also part of this conversation. So if we can separate these three components out and solve them individually, we can actually make some progress rather than trying to conflate them all and solve them all at once. And so just to summarize what these mean, the circumscription is about the content of a taxon. The classification is about the context of a taxon, what it's related to, what its associations are. And then the nomenclature is really just a text string label we use to communicate with each other. Now, these number two and number three, classification and nomenclature, those are actually relatively easy nuts to crack from an informatic perspective. There's been a lot of work on both. Sure, there's some little challenges that need to be resolved, but those are relatively easy. The really hard one to solve is that first one, circumscription. So that's what I'm going to focus on today. We do have explanations in this model I'm about to talk about for classification and nomenclature, but today I'm just going to focus on the really complicated one, which is circumscription. So what is a unit of a circumscription? How do you define what a taxon is based on a circumscription? And there have been many attempts to address this over the last couple of decades. You could enumerate all organisms, or you could enumerate only a subset of organisms which are explicitly identified by a taxonomist or examined by a taxonomist. You could use character states to define what the boundaries of these circumscriptions are. You could use populations. And you could, you know, one of the most probable and implementable versions is to use taxon name usage instances, which Walter Berenson called potential taxa decades ago, as your unit of what a taxon circumscription is. All of these have advantages and all of these have disadvantages. I won't go over to them all. You can look at the slide later if you want. And a lot of them aren't even listed on the slide. But the problem is we've not yet used any of these approaches to solve this problem from an informatic perspective. So what we need is a unit of circumscription that has these properties. It's scalable, it's objective, it's unambiguous, it's computable, you can do reasoning across it, it's consistent with existing data and taxonomic practices, and it's accommodating of the all too common problem of missing or incomplete data in our existing data set. So our proposal, in a nutshell, is sets of protonyms. So I'm sure that just answers all your questions and I can walk away and we're redundant. No, I have to explain this a little more. So what do I mean by that? All right, so let's start with a very simplistic representation of circumscription. So here are three taxa, and each of those dots represents an individual organism included within a hypothetical circumscription. And what do we do as taxonomists? We select one individual from within those circumscriptions, call it the name-bearing type specimen, and assign a scientific name to it. And then we start using that scientific name as a proxy to represent all the other dots inside those circles. And as you all know, that becomes problematic. So just a reminder from what I talked about yesterday about taxonomy and nomenclature. And this is a really key important thing to understand. It's not that type specimens are the taxon or even are the best representative of the taxon. They're usually not. What they are is the only objective link between a scientific name that we use in informatics all the time and the associated taxon or circumscription of all the organisms we imply by using that scientific name. And another subtle but important point to understand is that every scientific name has a name-bearing type behind it, regardless of whether we know what that type is. In most cases, that type is explicitly designated as a museum specimen in a collection. But even when we don't know what the type is, it exists implicitly. And that's a subtle point, but it's an important point. Every scientific name on there has a type, whether or not we know what that type is. All right. So what this diagram is intended to represent is that that type specimens are essentially proxies for their concepts. So every organism identified to a species name is a statement that that organism is conspecific with the type specimen of that name. All right, so I won't go into the nitty-gritty details, but you can use type specimens as proxies for their respective circumscriptions. All right. Every protonym, these are the core principles, and I'm going to go over them quickly, and you're going to have to come up to me for elaboration later because I don't have enough time, but every protonym corresponds exactly one-to-one to a name-bearing type. An identification of a non-type individual is an assertion that it is conspecific with the corresponding type specimen, what I just said. And this is a really important point that involves its own 15-minute presentation, but heterotypic synonyms are assertions that the type name of the synonym is conspecific with the type name of the valid name. And we can deduce from this that type specimens serve as proxies for all other organisms that have ever been or ever will be identified to that taxon. Protonyms serve as effective proxies for name-bearing types, and sets of protonyms serve as effective representatives of taxon circumscriptions. So let me remind you what a protonym is. So a protonym is a special case taxon name usage that is the first proposal of a new name. It's the anchor point that all subsequent usage is referred to. So the example I gave in yesterday's presentation involved these three species, Fischeri flavicauda and Cautoxanthurus. On the left-hand side, you see that each one of them is an implied concept when it's born as a protonym. And on the right, you'll see that there's a protonym set. They each consist of one protonym, which corresponds to those three circles. So essentially, we have three circumscriptions, each of which has a single type specimen serving as it. And then on the left, the C1, the C2, and the C3, those are the three circumscriptions. Each one may have one or many or more hundreds of taxon name usages. That's what all those SEC references are about. Okay, so here we have a case of a synonymy. Someone, Allen, in 1980 decided that flavicauda and Cautoxanthurus were the same species. So there's a heterotypic synonym. So there's a protonym set with a count of two, only one of which is the valid name according to the rules of nomenclature. And you can see in the diagram below, we now have two circumscriptions, one of them broader than what the previous one used to be. And then we have here another synonymy, which says, well, no, actually, these other two species are synonyms of each other, and Cautoxanthurus is the valid species. And then we have another taxonomic opinion that says, no, they're all the three same species. So in this case, C circumscription six actually has three separate protonyms within it. All right. So these are the ways that we can essentially distill down these proxies for taxon circumscriptions using the type specimens and the objective inherent implications of what statements about heterotypic synonymy mean. What's really nice about this approach is every single one of those is an RCC5 relationship that's automatically derivable from this protonym set model. No human is necessary to create all these RCC5 relationships, which again are useful for doing reasoning across lots of broad data sets. Now, it doesn't solve all the problems. There are edge cases that require a human interpretation involved, but this covers the vast majority of cases of vast majority of nomenclature. So what is this model? This is a model represents is a set of one or more protonyms, which is a proxy for a set of one or more name-bearing type specimens, which themselves are proxies for all organisms within the circumscription. Advantages are, I won't read them all, I don't have time, but if you access these slides, there's a whole bunch of advantages for why this is a good approach to take. So our goal in this exercise that we're involved with right now is to empower biodiversity knowledge through a clearinghouse of persistent identifiers for these circumscriptions, these protonym sets, consistent minted identifiers for each circumscription, resolvable protonym sets, which represent a gateway to all taxon name usages and therefore all literature, and supporting heterogeneous taxonomic viewpoints in a very computable way. So here's the kicker. It's really easy to implement. We already have the data, thanks to these sources in digitized form, thanks to all those bold-faced organizations that are harvesting historical and newly born literature. And we've already demonstrated that it's scalable using prior projects like UBio for Dave Remsen and GNUB for me. So that was a whirlwind tour through a really complicated topic, and it was just meant to stimulate your ideas and hope that maybe this can lead to further discussions and I can give you much more elaborate explanations of what I mean by all that. And it just went off perfectly. Was that the whole thing or was that including question time? Is there time for questions? Okay, great. All right, well, thank you.
So So I think we have 1 minute. I see a question from Carlos, but did anyone else want to jump in to open the room? All right, let's go with Carlos. Okay, question. What to do when the designation of the objective taxon or nomenclature link fails even after January 1st of 2000? For example, there are a species of Onychophora with many holotypes and additional paratypes per species, demonstrating that an apparently fail-proof term such as holotype can be misinterpreted by authors, reviewers, and editors in a row. What can nomenclature database staff do in such cases?
Yeah, so the full answer to that question requires a lot more than a minute, but the short answer is the actual properties of that type specimen don't matter. The type specimen is implied to exist. It's nice when you know what it is. It's nice when you know what its properties are. But the idea is that the protonym, when you created the name in literature in a code compliant way, you implicitly anchored it to some specimen, regardless of whether you know what that specimen is. Again, the full answer, Carlos, I think we're going to have to spend a little more time with, but it's a subtle but important point that you bring up and brought up the last time I gave this presentation. And it's something that requires a lot of knowledge of the code to really understand the correct answer. But I know that sounded like a dodge, but I promise I'm just trying to keep on time. But Carlos, I'll get back to you on that.
All right, and we're doing very well on time. And so we're actually going to have 15 minutes or so at the end. So for the question in the room, let maybe come back at the end and ask then. So that thank you to Rich. And now we have Olaf Banki talking about the catalog of life.
Okay, thank you very much. Also to the organizers, Nathan, Beckett, and others. What I just like to do is to give you a little bit of an explanation of where the catalog of life is at the moment and where we aspire to go to. Therefore, I call this talk From a List to a Service. I won't go so much into the detail, into the infrastructure, into Checklist Bank, because that's the next talk by Marcus Düring. It is a PDF, yeah. Okay. Thanks very much. Yeah, it's okay. It's super, actually. So, just to start out a little bit, like 2 years ago, there is this group under the IUBS that was conversing with, several policy initiatives like CITES, for example, or IUCN Red List, and we're saying like, hey, what's going on? Why do you use your own lists? Is there something that you're not comfortable with the current list that the community is producing, yes or no? And they came up with 10 principles as a sort of a way to see whether some of these policy initiatives could be persuaded actually to get more trust in the global lists that we have. And I won't go over in detail in these principles. Some of them are quite clear, like that we should provide transparency, et cetera, et cetera. But it just stirred a debate between the IUBS group and a consortium of Catalog of Life to see like, okay, yeah, indeed, why are some policy initiatives not making use of what we already have or start fortifying it? And I'll come back to it a little bit later, what Catalog of Life has responded to those principles. But at present, there is a working group that is working out in the back with some of those policy initiatives to figure out what we actually need to get more trust in what we are doing. Now, This slide, actually, I don't need to explain this to you, but I just use it very often to show to others that, lots of the information about a species is really tied to its name. If you do not have the name, then you don't know which information is actually fitting to it. Now, one of the problems I think we have in our biodiversity data landscape is that for an external user that doesn't understand or doesn't want to go in all the data that's behind it, what they want to do is just navigate between one information space and another and understand to what extent they're talking about the same species, yes or not. Now, overall, we have to also acknowledge, and that was already said before in a different talk, is that there are different perspectives from users, what they want out of it. And whilst a policy initiative might see one consensus list, you know, researchers would like to see something else and, much more in depth, probably related to taxonomic concepts, how one list is actually differing from another. Now, as Catalog of Life, what we've been doing over the past 5 years is really trying to move ourselves into this new era. And I'll come back to that a little bit more. It's actually the infrastructure that's driving that. But there's some recent improvements that I at least want you to be aware of if you aren't already aware of it. Now, of the 165 global databases that are underpinning the call checklist, the majority, actually only two, have not accommodated this, are on open data licenses. So this is a really good effort that we, have gotten the community that is underpinning the Catalog of Life to move their data on CC0 and CC BY licenses. Another part that we have been doing is really make clear to everybody that it's in fact not a very small team that enabling the Catalog of Life to come to fruition. It's actually a very, very large network of way over 500 experts worldwide. And then if I talk about experts, I'm not only talking about the taxonomists, but also all the people that manage data or the developers that make things happen. Now, we've at least created that this community is now more visible and part of the citation. Another important thing is that the call checklist is now really being made incremental every month. And that is because we have stable name identifiers, and also every monthly release is accompanied with a proper DOI. And so right now, it's the annual checklist that we really provide long-term support to. But this is a great improvement that you can now see across time better what the updates have been like. Now, if you look at this graph, the top line is showing you actually the accepted species. This is a graph going up to the end of 2021, when we were just going over 2 million accepted species. The orange line is really the synonyms, the amount of synonyms. And I just want to highlight that because you would actually expect that those synonyms, that line is much higher than the accepted species. But traditionally in Catalog of Life, not all data custodians are providing all the names that they have to the Catalog of Life. And this really becomes relevant. So what we've been doing as well as in response to those 10 formulated principles is to think ourselves more about the criteria for measuring progress of global taxonomic data sources that are underpinning the Catalog of Life checklist. Now, for each of these items, we sort of formulated a top goal, really what would be the blue sky thing that we would like to achieve, but also a set of minimum requirements that we want to see. And some of these items I just wanted to highlight, like number six, the continuous and current curation. That is really, as well as the stable delivery, getting data to the catalog of life is actually one of the top barriers that we have. Getting people to work in online tools, for example, is still hard. And also getting data in the appropriate formats, getting it up to the catalog of life. I just wanted to stress that. Now, on Thursday, I'll give a talk where I show how we implement these criteria. Now, going back to the biodiversity landscape, I mean, what really our vision has been over the last couple of years is to make sure that we collaborate more as Catalog of Life with other partners to make sure that, you know, we get an informed landscape to users. This is not an easy task. It is dream, but we are going to make it happen. One of the partners that we've really, really been closely working with is GBIF. And I really want to thank GBIF for all their years of commitment and believing in this work. So what we have been doing is, and this is a slide that you will see more often probably, is how it used to be is that you had a catalog of life, process and separately a GBIF backbone build that was building on top of the catalog of life. This is really not the preferred situation that we want to be in if you want to integrate your data more. So what we now have with the new checklist bank infrastructure is that we have the capability of bringing all the data that are underpinning the GBIF backbone and the catalog of life checklist into checklist bank. We're creating at the moment the called checklist out of this infrastructure, and we're building this semi-automated catalog of life checklist that is hopefully sufficient or a candidate for the replacement of the GBIF backbone taxonomy. Now, for catalog of life, this is really important because it would mean that we are extending the catalog of life checklist with a hell of a lot more names, but we also have a better way of updating, you know, where we have taxonomic gaps and no taxonomic community behind it. So lastly, Checklist Bank is really the infrastructure. I mean, Catalog of Life has no other tooling but the Checklist Bank. So all the tooling that we have to build checklists are in Checklist Bank. And I just wanted to highlight again this data flow from Platzi. Suddenly we have at our hands for Catalog of Life more than 43,000 data sets coming from published literature from PEMSoft or European Journal of Taxonomy, etc. And this will really, really change the way that we work. What we need actually is a real global workforce to help us strengthen what we do here. We are only a very small team in Catalog of Life. So if you see opportunities to collaborate, please come in. We know we have to do far more work to, I would say, get everybody connected to Checklist Bank, but Marcus will tell you a little bit more about that, and I hope you enjoy it. Thanks very much.
All right, thank you, Olaf. Time for a question, or do we want to move directly to Marcus's talk? Okay. All right, Marcus, I think it's yours. Go for it.
Okay. Let me see. All right. Hello, everyone. I'm Marcus Döring from Berlin, and we'd like to introduce to you a checklist bank that Olaf already mentioned. It's a joint development between GBIF and the Catalog of Life. Right, it's a checklist bank is a repository for taxonomic data. It contains currently more than 43,000 data sets. That includes all the ones that we use to build the call checklist. And all data sets, all checklist data sets that are registered with GBIF, which includes the vast number of more than 40,000 PLASI articles. We do support the different formats for getting data in and for publishing data to Checklist Bank, but also for retrieving with ColDP and the Darwin Core archives being the most relevant ones, especially for publishing as they're most expressive. In addition to the GBIF model of registering a URL where you can fetch an archive and then pulling it continuously, Checklist Bank also allows users to actively upload files directly. All data is then interpreted in Checklist Bank into a shared data model, which then allows us to offer user interfaces and an API for searching, browsing, and many other possibilities. The exact verbatim records are also accessible in a quite nicely linked verbatim browser because we know the structure of the underlying data model. Checklist Bank in general just serves the latest version of any data set, but it does archive the original files. So you can always access older versions as the entire archive. It also tracks historical metrics and a list of all names in a simple text tree file. Here's a quick overview of what the data model in ColDP looks like. The one implemented in Checklist Bank is not exactly like ColDP, but it's rather similar. And I'd like to mostly point out that there's three main entities where everything is kind of circulating around, which is the name and the taxon and the references. In addition, we also Checklist Bank provides projects data sets. Other than static external data sets, they can contain mutable data, and people can modify data with some tools that are provided. The main driver here is to build the Catalog of Life checklist. So there are a variety of tools that help you to assemble a single taxonomy out of many, many source data sets, which can then be added as a whole or just in parts. We offer on manual demand releases for projects, which then create immutable snapshots of the data, can attach device to releases, and provide the infrastructure to calculate stable name identifiers. This growing set of community tools that Checklist Bank offers, the basic first one that we offer is just a plain search of names across all data sets, so you can figure out where names appear. There is a name matching tool, which allows you to upload or just enter names, your own name lists, and then map them to any of the data sets in Checklist Bank. So GBIF offers a similar tool for the GBIF backbone. Checklist Bank now allows you to match to any of the data sets which are included in Checklist Bank. That's pretty nice for mapping your data to identifiers of whatever source you would like to match to. There is also a data comparison tool, which allows you to quantify and better visualize differences of a group treated in different data sets. So you can pick a genus, for example, and compare them between two different data sets and get some statistics, but also a name diff that highlights the differences. There's a couple of supporting tools to publish data into Checklist Bank. There's a metadata editor, so don't have to handcraft files. But most importantly, I think there is the issue flagging similar to GBIF does for occurrences there, where you can then, during import into checklist bank, various issues are flagged and noted to the user that they might need some review. You can also publish private data sets first. That is a data set that is only visible to a selected group of people that you want to have access to it. And changes over time are visualized as well. Data sets and checklist bank in general are isolated from each other. They are really not sharing any data between each other. But and in order to crosswalk names between data sets that are not exactly spelled the same way, Checklist Bank offers this names index, which is an automatically maintained central index of all unique names that we found across all data sets in Checklist Bank. And it does a bit of a gender stemming of epithets and can deal with some author variations to improve the linking. All names with authorship are grouped also in the index by their canonical name without authorship if broader results are needed. Just to be clear, the names index is not a global nomenclator. It does not claim to be right or wrong or anything. It is just a technical component to link names found in Checklist Bank. So it only contains the purely parsed name, no classification, no status. And identifiers are subject to change as we want to be able to improve the algorithms that we've implemented for clustering and parsing. Talking about taxon concepts in this room. So we haven't done this yet, but it is on our agenda, hopefully rather soon, that we do a similar thing as the names index. Taxon concept index. So we would like to see track all unique taxon concepts that are found in all data sets in Checklist Bank, regardless of the name which has been used. And to do so, we need to have a computable way to define a concept and to base it only on the available data alone. We cannot really rely on humans to input anything. Yeah. So we just heard from Rich Pyle the idea to use the set of types, the protonyms, which is included in a synonymy of a taxon. And that is definitely the way I think we should be going forward. It, to me, leaves one unfortunate thing where I'm still unclear about is some splits. For example, the one you can see at the bottom right there where ASBUS has been split into ASBUS and ASFUS. The protonym count, the types are just the same between the two versions of ASBS, if they're split or not. So the Strictu and Latu version really is the same according to the protonym sets. And I find that rather unfortunate. And I think most, yeah, and I think we can cover that. I hope at least to improve the resolution if we can treat property synonyms or some more sensu strictu, Latu annotations and authorships. And by matching, actually also looking at dates when people have published the names. So that gives also various hints of disambiguating which concept has actually been met. We do have an API. So Checklist Bank exposes all data in a RESTful JSON API, which is used by our user interfaces exclusively, also the Catalog of Life portal. And for authentication, we use the GBIF accounts, but pretty much all of the, it's only rare cases where we need them, like for private data sets. Otherwise, the data is wide open and open to anonymous access. And I'd like finally to point out one large design decision for the API and the data model, which is to reuse original identifiers. So all data in the API is scoped by the data set. So you have basically compound keys for names, taxa, and references consisting of a dataset key and then the local identifier, which is very nice because it allows us to preserve and reuse the existing identifiers without minting any new IDs and add to the confusion that we already have. Thank you very much. That was, check this back.
Awesome. Thank you, Marcus. I have a quick question to kick us off. I know Olaf had opened with talking about from the list to the services. Could you say a bit more about who you're thinking of as using the different services and interfaces you were describing in the talk?
It's probably quite a lot of different users, but especially the comparison tools are targeted more for taxonomists looking at actually the catalog of life itself. Like often we need to figure out which is a better treatment of a genus, which is more complete, where are the differences. So I think that's mostly taxonomists actually.
Sorry, I think either person? I think. Oh, go ahead.
Hi, Marcus. It's Donald Agost, Stephen Palazzi. Can you tell us something about the semi-automatic import of treatments? So, for example, that new species that can directly be imported don't have to wait in this long list of.
Yeah,
that are not imported yet.
All the Plasi lists, they get registered with GPIF immediately, right? If you have published something new in Plasi, and we synchronize the GPIF registry with Checklist Bank every couple of hours, so it just takes a few hours till they're at most till Plasi lists are available in Checklist Bank. They immediately get imported and are available as a standalone dataset right there. The catalog of life checklist is at this stage not yet using that, but we're working on quite a lot on this extended checklist, this semi-automated list, which then merges additional names which haven't been included in the catalog of life so far into the new list. Experimentally, I've tested that already with all the Plasi data sets, so that seems to be working, but there's still some small things that prevent us from going live with that. The idea is to always automatically, with every release of the catalog of life every month, include all the latest articles that come through Plasi to Checklist Bank.
I see a question in the chat. So to Olaf and Marcus from Andre, does policy relevant checklists find their place in Checklist Bank?
Well, I guess, Olaf, maybe you want to say something? Yeah.
Thanks, Andre, for that question. If I understand your question well, it was whether policy-relevant checklists find their way into Checklist Bank or whether it is actually intended to have them there. So maybe I'll answer the last one. Yeah, definitely, Checklist Bank can be used for any taxonomic checklist. Regardless whether they would be used in the catalog of life checklist, yes or no. In actual fact, we are working very closely together with the European Environmental Agency. That agency has already put or pushed some checklist in Checklist Bank just because they want it out in the open. So be mindful that indeed, national list or even thematic lists that are related to policy in any way, invasive species list or Redlist definitely are interested in, becoming part in Checklist Bank. And also, I would say any preliminary national list or of that sort is also of interest. Hope that answers the question.
Actually, have a quick follow-up on that. Could one submit historical checklists that another author created, like old extinct endangered species lists from the 70s, or would you have to be the author of the list to submit it?
It depends. So if there's consent with the person, then yeah, sure. If it's really a stale database, and the person is not present any longer, yes, definitely. I mean, we already actually have data sets or checklists in Checklist Bank where we know it will never be updated, but we'll keep them regardless in Checklist Bank. Obviously, metadata is important and licensing at that point in time.
Wanted to very quickly follow up on Marcus's point about the splits. So I had given Marcus you a kind of a rough outline. We spent months discussing that amongst Dave, Nikolai, and I, how to solve the split problem. We're pretty sure we came to a solution, but then more recently, we haven't talked to you since then. When we had our workshop in Hawaii, we spent a full day working through that and are confident that there's a very easy solution to managing that. It's not as complicated as it seems. So I'll get together with you on that afterwards and walk you through it.
Okay, and I think our last talk is by Laura Prado, who isn't able to join us live, but we have a recorded presentation.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your patience. I'm Laura Prado, and I will talk here on behalf of our group at Arizona State University about our proposal to extend the recognition for taxonomic curation beyond the traditional authorities. Taxonomy is undeniably at the center of modern biodiversity science, since primarily because it defines the dual name and meaning of species, which are the basic operational unit that allows biologists to study and classify organisms while linking observations from multiple sources. Along with the acceleration of digitization of biodiversity came the increased need for readily available taxonomic products. And this has also been driven by things like the biodiversity crisis and climate change. And this is reflected in the number of initiatives dedicated specifically to curating and publishing digital lists of accepted names, checklists of taxa that occur in a particular region, as well as systematic classifications of species in different groups. So how do we come to getting all these lists published? Well, if we consider that taxonomic curation can be described as a sort of a collage effort. We have multiple people and multiple disciplines working on small pieces of this patchwork or this puzzle with a diverse range of evidence and scientific resources all combined to form this body of work that results into a harmonious understanding of biodiversity. However, considering the history of taxonomy and taxonomic products that have been made available, they have been traditionally produced as lists of names without much regard for evidence or specimens. This has been changing, of course, but normally they are restricted to a small group of people who get the credit for their work, who are taxonomists or people with academic credentials. we do believe that there is a functional view of who the taxonomic curators should be. And this recognition should consider a broader spectrum of contributions that are made by individuals as well as organizations that might not necessarily self-identify as scientific authorities, but contribute to the definition of science as well. We believe that a wide net should be cast, and the concept of taxonomic curators should be expanded to include those people and projects that are responsible to gather and analyze information about biodiversity. If that information is validated according to an internally coherent set of taxonomic units, and if the people involved are participating in a social process of self-correction and engagement. And this should be considered rather than just taking into account the academic background of the people contributing. In this case, we should consider the integration with the digital extended specimen and the digital extended specimens network to include all those responsible for things like data cleaning of digital data, digital occurrence vetting in iNaturalist, for instance, name checking that are for lists that are submitted to GBIF or IDIS, people who investigate literature and publish the results in PLATSI, and so on. Expanding this concept could also help acknowledge the immense value that is provided by all this process of digitizing biodiversity, especially since now there are huge amounts of evidence available to support these alternative kinds of taxonomic expertise. Just for a current example, we have GBIF reporting currently over 2 billion occurrences mobilized through a great variety of sources. It's also interesting to notice that this digitization in such high volume has been possible in large part due to the development of content management software and tools for natural history collections, such as Arctos, Symbiota, and Specify, only to mention a few of the North American popular ones.
Our idea is that because these softwares and tools actually enable effective taxonomic curation, and because they provide especially a body of evidence that can be linked to all these lists of names and related taxonomic products, the people using the software and tools should actually be considered taxonomic authorities or curators, because they do the majority of the work necessary to provide those products, work that is not given enough credit. Something that is easily overlooked is that to create iNaturalist guides, for instance, of species existing in a particular region, or as the example on the right shows, the Arctic flora in the Consortium of North American Lichen Herbaria, which is a Symbiota portal. All of these lists take a huge amount of effort by different kinds of agents, and a lot of these agents are not given enough recognition for doing the work that is needed, such as to clean and validate data, to interpret the data, and also to annotate all the information coming from taxonomic labels existing in the specimens that are digitized through these tools. Although these efforts are not generally considered formal published or formal academic scholarship, these efforts actually do generate and author new species lists. And these lists normally have occurrences, which could be specimens or observations linked to those lists. And in our opinion, this should be considered evidence for taxonomic concepts that are established in the research group or institution responsible for the publishing of the data.
So even though many of the contributors to those biodiversity data portals or citizen science projects may not themselves identify as taxonomic authorities, they often display all the criteria that we consider needed for the progress in modern biodiversity science. So it is our opinion that we should try to incentivize the participation of those non-traditional taxonomic curators to encourage their continued contributions in networks that are formal or informal. We have a few suggestions that we think should be tested, like offering ways of producing digital publications and nanopublications as well that will generate digital object identifiers or DOIs, so we can track the contributions and their impact in the larger spectrum of science, as well as modernizing the criteria or the minimal criteria necessary for publishing evidence-based lists of taxonomic information. It does seem like many data publishers are open to this path, like we are seeing in initiatives now like the EDI and the Checklist Bank and Zenodo. And it is, in my opinion, an exciting time for taxonomy. Thank you for your attention. Please enjoy this lovely pun about taxonomy.
All right, and so we have a good 20 minutes for discussion. Thanks to all of our speakers for doing a wonderful time, or wonderful job managing time and giving us a chance to discuss, and lots of cool new ideas and perspectives, I think, that we got from the talks. So for the Zoom folks, if you could raise your hand or post in chat, and I'll maintain a queue here. And yeah, just give me a heads up if there are folks in the room. I think why don't we start with the person who had a question for Rich in the room, if they're still interested.
It's not really a question, it's just is proto protonym the same as basionym?
That's a great question. So there's whole articles written on this. A basionym is similar to a protonym, but are subtly different. So basionym in botany is the relationship between a subsequent combination and its original combination, that original combination would be the protonym, the original creation of that name. The problem of using that term is that it's not a basionym until a subsequent combination happens. So it's not born a basionym and only later becomes a basionym. And that's why we figured a new term, protonym. Also, protonym applies to all ranks all the way up to kingdom, whereas basionym generally only applies to species and below. So, but good question.
Well, I think one question to get us, oh, I see a hand. Nate, go ahead.
Yeah, just to sort of follow up with Rich on that a little bit in the context of these protonym sets, are you thinking that this there's some way to operationalize this? Like, since there's a needed like digitization step of what all those sec protonyms mean, and how do you represent those? Some are larger than others, or are you thinking about it as like each one is just a unit, and then you're interchanging them?
Each one is just a unit. It's an informatic solution to allow you to do reasoning across identifiers. It's not a method to pick up a specimen to decide what name to attach to it. That's what a taxonomist does. What we're trying to do is take the core distillation of what taxonomists do, reduce it to its most simple objective forms, and triage as many of these taxon concept relation problems as we can across data sets where we don't have taxonomic experts to do that manually. So also, one of the points I made in one of those slides that I brushed over is that it's accommodating for incomplete or missing data. So the point is, you don't need to know the full literature citation of an original description. Like, I know you don't always, like we talked about this before, you don't always have that for the mammal data. You don't need that to mint an identifier. You know that it existed, right? You know that if this is a scientific name that's used in taxonomy, there was a protonym out there, kind of like I was talking about type specimens. You know it's out there. You'll flesh out the metadata for what it is later. You'll get that journal article and volume and pages and all that stuff. You can fill that out later. That doesn't necessarily stop you from minting an identifier to represent that protonym and therefore engage in this network of taxon concept circumscriptions. I'm not sure if that's what you're asking, but.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think this idea that it's a unit is interesting and helpful. And then you just need to have an index of what all of those SEC references are, or just like, you know, who had a different usage than someone else. So there is still some needed bioinformatic thing, right?
Exactly. And though that content has been laboriously assembled by, you know, tried and true people, like starting with Charles David Sherborne and you know, Bill Eschmeyer and some of these people who sort of painstakingly over decades catalog that, thanks to EJT and Plotsy and Pensoft, you know, those are now being born in a structured format. And with a little bit of tweaking and a little bit of AI, we can harvest them not only from there, but potentially BHL content as well. So in other words, it won't be too hard, you know, first of all, to start with the ones that already exist in databases. A lot of the GSDs that contribute to global species databases that contribute to Catalog of Life already have that granularity of data. It's just the Catalog of Life model doesn't capture it all. But what Marcus is working on with Checklist Bank and Olaf was talking about is moving in that direction to be able to, a lot of the stuff's already out there. It's just not well consolidated and organized. But even the stuff that's sort of out there in semi-digitized form, like scan BHL pages, is harvestable with, you know, a mixture of dedicated people, armies of citizen sciences and AI. I think we'll be able to essentially fill in a lot of those gaps pretty quickly.
Well, one question. Oh, someone in the room. Okay.
Hi, that's Donald again. So I would just reiterate that essentially what Rach is talking about, that we can find from a treatment, the protolog is already in place. So if you go actually to Checklist Bank, it includes synonyms. That means treatments cite treatments, and treatments, they have a section normally which says, okay, this is the protolog, or here are the previous treatments. And that's already formalized, that's in TextPub. So there is a schema for it. It's applied in the journals which have been mentioned, like Sue Keys and Pensoft. It's used by us now to add to all these 40,000 entries to Checklist Bank. So that's already in place. So what would be really interesting though is that if somebody in iNaturalist would say, okay, I identify a species according to this thing. For example, you identify a species according to the mammal species of the world. So you add the ID of the mammal species of the world treatment, then we will be in a really good position, because then we know, okay, this guy identified this bird or this mammal according to that. And this allows them to make use of the history of names. We know this is actually based on this protolog, but we can also go back and say this is probably not that, because this is not cited according to this. So I think it would be really advantage if you start thinking treatments, if you start thinking of not just adding the authority of a specialist to say this is species X, but actually say species X refers to this taxonomic treatment.
Joe Miller, GBIF. This discussion on taxonomic concepts is great, and I'm loving where it's going, and we're going to move there. That's fantastic.
But there are still, you know, the biggest feedback we get at the Secretariat and the help desk, many people here in the room, is about taxonomic names, and people are very kind and say, you know, why are you using this name instead of that name? But what Olaf and Marcus just described, that's your on-ramp. So that's your opportunity of getting these data sets into the system and very easily get them into the GBIF backbone. Checklist Bank provides that on-ramp for these missing data sets to get them in the GBIF backbone relatively rapidly and be able to see that impact very quickly. So that's kind of the big picture here, is that now that those ideas, those data sets that you have can fill in, we have a pathway to fill in those dark areas of the GBIF taxonomic backbone through Checklist Bank. And that's very exciting first step, and the concepts right behind it.
Well, so maybe one follow-up. Hard to stay up with the room.
Yeah, so Donald again. So in the new data, GBIF data model, as I understand, there's treatment and treatment citations are already integrated. So, I mean, the way is really open for that. I'm very grateful to Tim and Joe that they make this effort to enhance the new data model to accommodate this relationship, which also allow, and furthermore, treatment citation is important because it essentially there where synonyms are made. So in this relationship, in an article, you actually say, okay, this, I cite this previous treatment and I say, this is a synonym. That's where essentially the catalogers go in and say, oh, he makes a synonym now, he puts in his database. And we can formalize that too. And that's essentially great now that, this is flowing through all to Checklist Bank.
So the question I want to raise then is, what about the other direction, right? So how can, and this is maybe for Emily and Samantha and for Olaf and Marcus, right? As folks feed the lists in either through, you know, making thesauri or the GIST, how does the credit and recognition or other sort of resources flow back to the folks contributing there? What does that picture look like for us here?
Well, if I can start quickly, I don't know, there's probably several answers.
Sure, and then saw Emily was going to jump in, so let's have Emily go after Marcus.
At least all sources and the Catalog of Life checklist, and that will be true also for the extended catalog, they each one of them has metadata with it, attributing who has created and was working on it, and we create the DOIs even for the data source within the Catalog of Life. So it's not only one DOI for the entire Catalog of Life release, but for each and every source that has been used to assemble the Catalog of Life, there is a sub DOI, if you like, which can be cited and is linked at least in the citation graph.
And Emily, did you want to jump in?
Yeah, I was going to say, similarly, we also feel that stable identifiers and DOIs are the way to go in order to have every component citable and sourceable. But we still feel that there's a bigger conversation here, particularly in how we're actually giving credit for everybody who's along this pipeline. Particularly through publication, when there's really not right now at this point a way to fully articulate that without giving authorship to people. And even that is really not enough for all of the individuals who've contributed to the taxonomy itself, particularly in a biodiversity project where there's so much data and you can cite the data set, but not necessarily the taxonomy behind all of that data. So I think that we think this is much broader of a conversation to continue to have and to push for, particularly for journals and how we can like really address that.
And I know that Joe, sorry, someone speaking.
Sorry, this is Olaf. I wanted to step in if possible. thanks, Emily. I think you're spot on that this is a broader discussion. I mean, For one part, I think we're improving now infrastructure and collaborations, et cetera, et cetera. But We need to recognize that a lot of the people that actually do the work behind it, the taxonomies, et cetera, very often do this voluntarily or next to their job, et cetera, et cetera. So, so I think, yeah, while doing this, we also need to recognize more the taxonomic community behind it and make sure that we go back to government's policy initiative and say, look, we are really getting together our act here together and maybe try to funnel more funds into this direction. We're not there yet, but that's certainly on the radar.
And I mean, I think
this is Joe again.
No, go ahead, Joe. I was going to talk about you anyway, so go for it.
Okay, so just one quick thing. So it's kind of a test study. The legume community, which I'm part of, we wrote a paper in which we updated the legume taxonomy and brought it into Checklist Bank and then brought it into GBIF Taxonomic Backbone, and we can measure how many occurrences were improved by that taxonomic effort. So we can go back to the legume community and say to them, you know, there are 10,500, I don't know the number off the top of my head, 10,528 occurrences that used to snap up to the genus level. Now we can attribute to the species level because you put those names in. So you have that. So that's one way of attribution. Then you can take that to your funder and say that taxonomy helped not only this study, but it also helped GBIF, which you're also supporting as well, and made the image, the digitization project that you did in a different institution more valuable because you're able to make sure that that taxonomy was consistent across all of them.
Samantha, did you want to jump in?
Oh, Jessica, thank you. Yes, for our case in the Guatemala portal, for example, we use this checklist more like an internal resource, but our hope is also to get this checklist published and even shared to GBIF as checklist in Darwin Core format. So we're hoping that at some point we will also get credited for this work.
So this is James in the room again here. I'm surprised none of my colleagues in the attribution task group have said anything since they just published a paper on how to do exactly what you're talking about. And this is a standard in a standard way. So we think about that a lot here. Attribution has been very big on the radar. It's been in so many talks over the last few years. Again, it needs the standards. It needs the base in order to understand how we push it up. We don't have the annotation solution, which is part of our problem, and putting identifiers on people, but David Shorthouse's work on bionomia, et cetera, is really pushing us into a place where we know more about the people. I mean, that focuses on collectors, but we just need to do the same across the board. And I think all of us here probably are, none of us would argue that this is exactly what we need to do. We should give credit where credit is due.
All right. Any other last thoughts? Yeah.
Well, since the room got quiet, I wanted to talk about another use that we've been experimenting with or implemented. And this is to sort of the data quality that we talked about this morning. So we've been working with Marcus and Dimitri Moserin using both global names and the checklist bank. And we're using it in our collection management system. So I talked a bit about Dina. It's all service-based. We use those services to provide quality data to the people so that when they see what they're trying to input, legacy or not, they can assert that this is the string that they want to use. So you have your verbatim, you should always use verbatim, but then you can assert a string. And the nice thing is that if you assert that name string, you can then assert a classification or a set of names that are part of a hierarchy in the at that minute, because we know those things change. And with the value of that, you don't even have to show it to the users necessarily, but the value is for searching, for discovery. So all of a sudden now you're able to ask questions like when a user comes to you and says, tell me everything I have in this family, Well, now you can backtrack that to all genera, the synonyms, the species. It's fantastic. Are there gaps? Yeah, of course. And we get lots of complaints about that. But the beauty of it is when they complain, you say, well, then fill the gap. So I think once we get there, we're going to have this fabulous resource that will clean up and be better in the data quality sense before the names get then pushed up into the aggregators. So there's a nice circle here.
I see Nate has a hand up, and that I think this will be our last to finish.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, it's been really great discussion, you all. I just wanted to kind of tie the loop in like the sort of the credit model idea and what we were talking about with these sort of smart data, maybe just range map or a diagnostic DNA sequence. A lot of that would be for kind of retrospectively assigning a name usage, like the concept of a given name to the data sources, right? And so when someone uploads a new thing, we can provide a way for them to link it to a taxonomy. But like for everything that's in a museum collection, you can either just assume that it's all, you know, according to some standard taxonomy, or you can try and disambiguate it. Sort of.
All right. And so I think we're out of time. Thanks so much to Holly and to all of the other folks in the room that made this all work with the Zoom and the in-person. Thanks to all of our speakers and to everyone who came. It was a great discussion.